are here for supporting Palestine.
Yeah.
Instead of looking for something, we're just always giving them the thought we're looking for something. And if they're always afraid, they're always uncertain, they're always confused, they will never do terror, right?
Hello, my name is Stanley Heller. Welcome to The Struggle. The Struggle is shown on 22 cable stations from Vermont to New York City, on the internet at thestruggle.org. We begin in Galway, Ireland, a rally to commemorate the 1,400 Palestinians killed in the Gaza Massacre. This occurred at the very end of December in 2008 and stretched on for over 20 brutal days. The Israelis call it Operation Cast Lead. They killed over 300 Palestinian youths, including 60 who were less than 6 years old. Then a talk from an Israeli dissident, a soldier, a veteran, Eran Efrati, who spoke at a Tree of Life conference in Hartford. He talks about the basic strategy of the Israeli army in its West Bank occupation, constant harassments and house occupation and intimidation, all to create feelings of powerlessness and fear. Before we begin, an exciting announcement. Max Blumenthal is going to come to Connecticut for a talk very soon. He's the author of Goliath, which talks about what's going on inside of Israeli society. He'll be speaking in Connecticut Monday, January 27th, in the late afternoon at Central Connecticut State University. Go to our website, thestruggle.org, for details. We start in Galway, Ireland.
Richard, would you like to say a few words on why we're here?
Well, we're here obviously to celebrate, or not to celebrate, but to commemorate the 5th anniversary of Operation Cast Lead.
Yeah.
And all the hypocrisy that's attached to that. And hopefully in this new year we'll see a bit more justice in the world.
Yeah, this woman beside you, Mary Jennings, she's doing good starting work in Gaza, yeah?
That's right, Mary Jennings here. It works with the Palestine Trauma Center on one of their projects called the Focusing Project.
And have you been to Gaza this year, Mary?
Yeah, so we were there in February, and it really was really awful. You know, much deteriorated an awful lot in the last year. People's mood was very poor, and the sense of hopelessness was much, much worse than it had been the year before since I was there.
Yeah.
And conditions are bad. No electricity. We're finding it hard to keep the project going by contacting them by email and all that, because they have no electricity. So hopefully 2014 we'll keep on, we'll keep slogging away and keep trying to support them.
Yeah. All right then, Mary.
Thanks now.
So you're from Saudi Arabia?
Yes.
Would you like to say a few words to the camera about why we're here?
Yeah, we are here for supporting Palestine.
Yeah.
And I hope everyone come out here. And thanks for Ireland government for give freedom to their... to other human. Thank you very much.
Yeah, all right. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Joseph, you want to say a few words?
Yes, we've organized this vigil now today to commemorate 5 years since Operation Cast Lead, and to show that the people of Galway stand in solidarity with the people of Palestine. It's been organized by the NUIG Palestine Solidarity Society, who are also campaigning to have the Students' Union and NUIG adopt the aims of the Boycott, Divestment and Sanctions movement.
You're from Saudi Arabia?
Yes, we are.
And you want to say a few words why we're here tonight?
Actually, we are here to support the case of Palestine, to free Palestine and make the world recognize Palestine as a state, as an independent state from Israel.
Now to Hartford, Connecticut, to a talk by Eran Efrati. Part of his family lived in Palestine, Israel for 7 generations. He's on a speaking tour of the United States with Maya Wind.
My name is Eran Efrati. I'm 28 years old now. And I'm from Jerusalem, born and raised. Actually, from my father's side, I'm a 7th generation in Jerusalem. It's pretty rare.
And from my mother's side, I'm not. My mother's side came from the Holocaust, came from Hungary. And I remember the first time I heard about the Holocaust was in the first grade when I was 7. And it wasn't at home, it was in the classroom from our teachers. And the only message we really got was that everybody wants to kill us. I grew up learning that my grandma survived Auschwitz and that all of her family died, as well as my grandpa, who did not went to a camp and survived the war and lost his wife and kid there, his first wife and kid. I grew up in Jerusalem when the soundtrack of my youth was the Second Intifada. It was the bombing in Jerusalem and our airplanes of Israeli army going over our head to blow something up, probably for good reason, I guess, then. I remember the ceremonies. We got the Holocaust Memorial Day, and straight week after, from a week after that, it's a Soldier Memorial Day, and then a day afterwards is our Independence Day, or Nakba Day. And I remember as growing up thinking, it's not so different. I mean, in the ceremony of the Holocaust Memorial Day was the same kind of things we learned in the soldiers of today, of all the wars of Israel. And I remember, you know, the songs was the same and the message was the same. And I came back home and I spoke with my grandma for the first time and started hearing stories from her life. And one of the stories that stick with me for a long time was the last time she saw her father. The last time she saw her father was in a Budapest ghetto when she was 11 years old, and Nazi soldiers went into the ghetto and just took him and some other men. And she never understood why. And I guess I was 15 or 14 and I didn't really care about her father. I was really amazed by the fact that after all these years, she's still wondering why. You know, we know that the Holocaust happened, we know the results, we know everything, but she still couldn't handle the uncertainty of the situation of a girl 11 years old in a ghetto trying to understand why him and why now. And I remember telling myself that if ever, ever I will be in a situation like this, ever in my life, I will go in the right path. I will be the human that people were not there at that time. I will hug this little girl. I will bring her back her father. I will do it. Like most of the kids my age at 17, in the 11th grade, I went off to a trip to Poland, to the camps. And we walk around and we got to Auschwitz. And in Auschwitz, I got to the same room, the same hut that my grandma used to sleep in. And in that room, there was a surprise. Every kid in the delegation get a letter from home, and I got a letter from my grandma that was handed to me on our bed, on her bed, in Auschwitz. And the letter was amazingly sensitive and loving, and I wish I just could read it to you right now. You know, it was something like, Irani, you're such a good kid, and you got such a big heart, but you're really taking everything upon yourself. Just let it go. You know, the Holocaust happened, and just let it go. It was amazing. And then I finished reading the letter to the rest of the delegation, and my guides came up to me and said, well, Eran, you do understand what she really meant to tell you in the letter, right? And I said that she loves me and that everything's okay. He said, no. What she really meant to tell you in the letter was that the Holocaust never ended. That we are always in fear that the Jewish people will not be. And that the only thing your grandma really wants and needs you to do is go back home, join the best unit you can do in the army, and fight for her. Fight for her security. So I said, okay, if this is my grandma wants, I will do it. And I came back home, and like the rest of my friends, most of us, except for some of people, but it's very little, I did. I came back home, I took a year off to work with children because education was really important for me and I love children. But straight after, I joined the IDF and I went into boot camp. And I felt like this is my mission. I'm gonna do it and I'm gonna combine. I'm gonna combine security for my people with, you know, the loving man I am, you know, with kids and education. And I will be this good soldier at the checkpoint, if you will. And I went into boot camp. This is me, young and handsome. I joined the army, I joined the boot camp, and I started my boot camp, and we prepared for war. For 7 months, we prepared for war. And it was not fun. But it was important, because we're gonna meet war, right? Well, wrong. Actually, since 1973, Israel was not in a real war. You know, war like we know it, like army against army and tanks against tanks and airplane against airplanes. We had our army fight what we call terrorist militia or groups, but there wasn't a war in the last 40 years. So what are we preparing to? Well, not where we're going to. After 7 months, I found myself in Hebron, El Halil, a very big city in the middle of Palestine. If you've never been there, don't go. I think there's only one phrase who can really, really describe Hebron, and it's probably the darkest place on earth. When I went there, I didn't really understand what happening, because I was waiting for the tanks and the airplanes, but there was just people going from our home, their home, to schools, on the roads, and we're there in the middle. It's a city of 180,000 Palestinian people, and split in the middle, you got 800 settlers. On them, you got 500 soldiers, a couple more hundreds during weekends, and then something like 300 policemen, Israel policemen. And our job was quite clear. We just need to stand there and stop terror. But we didn't really understand what does it mean. My first impression of Hebron, or maybe my second or third or fourth after I went out of my shock, was that the fact that kids in Hebron, the Palestinian kids, look at me in terror. And I couldn't understand it, you know, because why would someone look at me with terror? I was this loving, really cute and handsome young man. And of course, I had my uniform on and my vest, my 2 grenades, my 6 buckets of ammunition, my short M16, and some colors on my face. But hey, I was this handsome young man. And I remember coming back home and talking with my mom and telling her that I don't really understand why are they afraid. You know, I wouldn't do anything to them. And we thought about it, and I get it. What kids like, you know? I'm gonna bring candies to the army. And I did. I brought candies to the army. The most popular one was Bamba, the peanut butter snack of Israel. It's very good, I do recommend that. And I went to Hebron, and it worked. I started giving candies to the kids. They actually started to recognize me and came over to me and asked for candies. One of these times, I was standing in my guard when kids came out of the schools, and I saw this kind of chubby, cute, something like 8 years old kid going with a bag with twice his size and coming to me and looking at me and saying, Bamba? And I said, yeah. And I reached out with a bag of Bamba and I offered him. And instead of taking the bag and run like his other friend, he sat down and he opened the bag and he offered it to me back. And we shared the snack. And it was this amazing moment of like 2 minutes. Amazing moment of clarity that I did my job. I fulfilled my meaning in my life, maybe. I'm guarding Israel. I'm not sure how, but I'm guarding Israel. And I'm sharing, you know, the snack with the kid. This is it. All the barriers
our cross. He's gone. I'm finishing my guard. I'm so happy. You know, I'm on clouds. I'm going back to the base after 6 hours. And I'm thrilled. Nobody understands why I'm smiling in this, you know, hell. And I'm going into the base, and some soldiers come to me and say to me, Efrati, this is my last name, this is how we talk in the army. Say, Efrati, we're sorry, but you have to go to another mission. You know, you didn't sleep, you didn't eat, but we don't have enough people, and you have to do another mission. And you know what? I didn't care, because I was so happy. I was really thrilled. And the mission that we had to do at night was something called mapping. Mapping basically is taking a piece of paper, 7 soldiers, and going into houses in the middle of the night. It's houses you choose in advance, and you're going into them around 4 o'clock in the morning because you want the people to be there, and it's a good hour usually. And we're going into the house, and some guy is mapping the house. All the family is coming out of the house, and only the father of the family is going with the officer and another soldier, you know, protected the armed officer, and going into the house and checking all the rooms and checking all the drawers and checking if there's weapons there. And one guy is mapping that, and it's a really good reason to map it. We map it because if one day there will be a terror attack from this house, we know exactly how the house is built. So we know, you know, if there's a back exit and a window here and all the rest. And in that night, I was chosen to do the mapping. And I was thrilled again because of the kid and because I'm really good at drawing. And we're going to 2 houses tonight, and we're going out. We're knocking on the 4th door. Everybody out, army, everybody is coming out in a freezing January, snow in Hebron in 2007. And my officer is going with the soldier and with the man, and they're finishing the tour. And after 20 minutes, everybody coming back home. A little less home, but everybody is coming back to it. We're doing our second house, and we're doing great timing. And my officer was a very fine soldier, decided that if we can do the 3rd house before sunrise, let's do it tonight. Maybe we won't do it another night. And we said, okay, 1 less house. It's like 5 in the morning, it's already signed to be done, and we're going into this 3rd house. And I'm still thrilled from my afternoon, so I don't care. It's 5 in the morning and I didn't sleep, and I don't care, I didn't eat or talk with my mom or my girlfriend. And we're going into the house. Jish, army, get out of the house. Everybody's going out to the snow. We're going on. I'm drawing the house. The officer is going with the soldier. The rest of the soldier is guarding the family outside. I'm drawing the house, and I'm wondering in my dreams about my afternoon. And all of a sudden, I see a door open to my right, and it's a kid's room. And in the kid's room, there's a puppet of Winnie the Pooh. And I love Winnie the Pooh. So I'm going in. And then I see him, the kid from this afternoon. And he's naked. And he's shaking. And I'm pointing my gun at him. And I can't really take it down, because I'm shaking myself. And I can't believe this is happening to me, because we have this great bonding already. So what the hell is going on? And why is he naked? And what am I doing in his room? And all of a sudden, I didn't really understand what the hell is going on. And after a few seconds like that, that seems like 20 minutes for me, his father see me pointing his gun, my gun, to his 8-year-old boy, and he's running into the room. But instead of pushing me, he starts slapping his kid. It's slapping and slapping and it's hitting his kid. And he's looking at me and says, please, 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 I will take care of him. Please, please, don't take him. Please, I will take care of him. Don't worry, I will punish him. Don't worry, I will punish him. And he's slapping the kid. And I don't understand. I'm just trying to say, no, 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 no. It's okay, it's okay, it's okay. But I'm not able to say anything because my officer is coming in and he thinks the guy is acting very strange. So we do what we do with people that act strange in Palestine. We arrest them. It doesn't matter if you're 8 years old or 80 years old, we arrest you all the same.
We're taking you, we're putting a piece of fabric around your eyes, we're tying your hands behind your back with plastic bars, and we're shoving you into a car, into our army car. So we took the father, we shoved him into the car, and we drove away. We got to the base and we did what we do with most of the people we arrest to punish them. We just put him in the entrance of the base. And he just sat there. During this time, I was just thinking, maybe I can go back and talk with the kid. Maybe I can just explain to him everything's okay. Maybe I can go to the father and give him something to drink. But I didn't really do nothing. And I just went to sleep and got up, and he was still there. And I went to my guard for 6-8 hours, and I came back, and I went to sleep, and I ate, and I talked with my girlfriend, and I told her I love her, and I told her I would see her on the weekend. And I went back to sleep, and I went to my guard, and he was still there. During this time, I got a call from my father. Like a lot of times before, the news in Israel is talking about us or other soldiers around us, quoting the IDF spokesman. And my father called me to say, hey, congratulations. We heard during the weekend you arrested some very wanted terrorists. And I didn't say anything to him. Although we talked about it a lot of times, but then I was so embarrassed. All I could say was, yeah, it was really dangerous. And after 3 days, the father is still sitting there, tied to the fence, we're just letting him go. Just like that, he's going home. This is it. This is the end of the story. I'm not going to give you a great ending. It's just going home. But when he's going home, I remember that I, because of the shock of that night, didn't give my officer the drawings of the free houses. I know it's really important mission. I know I'm hurting now, but it's an important mission. So I'm going into my officer office and I'm telling him, hey, officer, I forgot to give you the papers. Here they are. I got them with my life. I said, ah, it's okay. You can throw them away. I said, what? What do you mean? It's like the important job we're doing every night. And says, well, Efrati, come on. You're not in booth camp anymore, come on. I'm saying, what? What's going on? He says, well, you do know we occupy, I don't think he said occupied, yeah, but let me embellish. He said, you know we occupied Hebron in 68, right? He says, yeah, sure. He says, do you know that since 68, there's soldiers here 24/7, right? 36.5 days a year. I said, well, yeah, of course. What has this got to do with anything? He says, you do understand that every house in Hebron was entered through the night something like 100 times, right? And I said, no, I don't understand that. What do you mean? He said, well, we're still stopping terror. We're just doing it in a different way. Instead of looking for something, we're just always giving them the thought we're looking for something. And if they're always afraid, they're always uncertain, they're always confused, they will never do terror, right? And I said, I guess. And I went back and I went to sleep. And I got up and I went to my mission and I went to sleep. And it continued for 3 years because I was never in my conscious that there can ever be another way. I could not go back home and tell my father I'm quitting the army, right? And I do not have any friends if I do that. So I continue for 3 years. I finished my service as a sergeant, and I joined a group called Breaking the Silence. I'm going to do it very short because I'm not talking in the name of Breaking the Silence. I joined Breaking the Silence. I worked there for 2.5 years, and we collect testimonies of soldiers in the occupied territories and gave it to the Israeli public, and I was sure, I was really sure, that if the Israeli public just know what I know, the occupation have to stop, right? It will stop. But it didn't. For 2 years, after Kaslid, after we killed 1,500 people in Gaza, after we gave all the information out there. But then I understand another thing. We're not giving all the information out there. The reason is the army censorship. Apparently, the army censorship is applying on breaking the silence. Like any other newspaper in Israel, like any other journalist in Israel, you cannot publish something that the army censorship not allowing you. So basically, we never know what is happening and what is not. We never know what is real and what is not. All we got is the idea of spokesman narrative. All we got is the idea of spokesman lies. One of the most read newspapers in Israel today, is the readest newspaper today, is Israel Today. That's the name. They started having a free, they give it a free a few years back when I was a soldier. They gave the newspaper free and everybody took it. This is how we as soldiers got to know about the situation from the newspaper. This is how we learn what we're doing is what we're doing. And I'm going to speed it up for you. There's nothing free in life. The newspaper was free since the beginning and until now. But now we know there's someone paying for this newspaper. The owner of Israel Today, the most read-up newspaper in Israel, is Sheldon Adelson. The same guy who's paying the money for the Republican Party is paying the money for the knowledge of the Israeli people and the Israeli soldiers. We're trying to go into the Israeli circles. Me and Maya grew up in Jerusalem. We are Israelis. We went through what everybody went through. We wish it could happen from there, but it doesn't, for a lot of reasons. From knowledge-wise, from fear, from money, from economic, it does not happen. And it have to happen from here. It have to happen from you, because wanted or not, you are a crucial factor in the occupation of Palestine and the occupation of the Israeli people by their army state. You're not only giving us money, you're giving us the back to do it in the world. We started with Martin Luther King, and I will finish with Martin Luther King, to your honor, Reverend. The great Dr. Martin Luther King said, and I'm sorry if it's a little awkward, I'm reading it from Hebrew to English. Eventually, what hurts us more, it's not the words of our enemies, it's the silence of our friends. And we ask you, friends, today, to please stop, be silent, and join us in the call for boycott, divestment, and sanction on the Israeli state to liberate us and the Palestinians from this occupation. Thank you very much.
That's our program for today. See you next week at this time. I'm Stanley Heller, and this is The Struggle.